God is good all the time. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. We once again want to salute you in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Tonight, I want to welcome Elder Lekolwane, Personal Ministry Director for EAD Eastern Africa Division, who will present to us a special item. Pastor Lekolwane, please.
My Christian brothers and sisters, tonight, the Lord has blessed the Eastern Africa Division in a special way. We have our fellow believers, our fellow pastors, our co-workers in the ministry who have decided to travel all the way from Rwanda to this place. And at this point in time, I would like them to introduce themselves by mentioning their names and telling us what they are doing as they work for the Lord. We will start with you, Chief.
Good evening, brothers and sisters. My name is Pastor Eliezer Munyakarama. I'm Sabah School and Church Ministry Director in Rwanda Union Mission.
My name is Jacques Nyinzingabo. I'm in charge of Education, Youth and Communication Department in Rwanda Union Mission.
I am called Habiyambere Abel, and I work as Associate Treasurer in the Rwanda Union Mission.
Mon nom est Nirema Efast. Je suis laïque et ancien de l'Église.
Et mon nom également, c'est Jérôme Gasasira Rutagengwa. Je suis le vérificateur de l'Union de Rwanda Union.
Amen. Mr. Church Ministry's Director, before the Education Director presents us before the Lord, would you be kind enough to tell us in one sentence what the Lord is doing through this program in your beautiful country?
Well, in Rwanda Union Mission, our membership is 325,000. And then our church members are working hard. Even laymen nowadays are trying to plan for the campaign, evangelist campaign in these days. There are more than 2,000 people in each church who are attending this crusade. And you will see that we have more than 40 sites in Rwanda, and there are some laymen who are ordering dishes individually. We have two baptistries which are mobile, which are made by a layman and are helping us to baptize many people. Even prisoners are being baptized. Last month, we baptized more than 500 prisoners, and everything is going on well. We hope that the Lord will be with us even in the future. Thank you very much.
Let's stand up for prayer. Notre Dieu, notre Père, nous te sommes infiniment reconnaissants de ton amour et de ta protection qui ne cesse de nous accompagner au jour le jour. Que ton nom soit glorifié. Nous te sommes infiniment reconnaissants, Seigneur, de ce que tu as permis que cette campagne soit organisée pour toucher les cœurs de tes enfants. Nous te prions, Seigneur, que pendant ce programme va commencer, que le Saint-Esprit puisse s'emparer chacun d'entre nous qui est engagé dans ce programme, afin que ce soir, Seigneur, ta parole puisse toucher les cœurs de ceux qui écoutent ta parole, afin que tout le monde puisse se préparer à te rencontrer lorsque tu reviens bientôt. Nous voulons te prier plus particulièrement pour le prédicateur, afin que le Saint-Esprit puisse l'utiliser, en fait que le Saint-Esprit puisse toucher sa bouche et que tout ce qui va sortir de sa bouche puisse édifier tes enfants et nous préparer à te rencontrer lorsque tu reviens bientôt. Nous te prions, Seigneur, que tu puisses continuer à œuvrer à travers tes enfants et que, Seigneur, tu nous prépares à te rencontrer et que lorsque tu reviendras sur les nuées, nos noms puissent paraître inscrits dans le livre de vie. Ce sont les grâces que nous te prions au nom et par l'amour de notre Seigneur et Sauveur Jésus-Christ. Amen.
Welcome, friends, to Christ 2001. Jesus loves you, friends, wherever you are tonight and whatever you have done, Jesus loves you. In Exodus, Moses wrote down 10 commandments. Tonight, we are going to be talking with a doctor about one of those, about sexual purity in marriage. We're here to tell you that God believes in sexual purity in marriage, both before and during. One of the largest problems in our society today is the breakdown of the family, due to a lack of faithfulness to God's law. A huge problem as well in our world today is the problem of AIDS. And part of the reason for that problem is because so many people are not willing to wait and do things according to God's plan. Maybe they feel it's the pressure of their society. Maybe they feel that everybody is doing it. But Natalie and I, who have been married 3 years, say that not everybody rushes to do these things before marriage. We are here to tell you that we have waited, and you can too. We encourage you and challenge you to do that. Tonight we have with us a doctor who will explain more things about this suffering that can happen and is happening to cause terrible things like AIDS in the world. Now, if you are a person who has not waited 1 John 1:9 in the Bible says that if we confess our sins, God is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to wash us pure. So we wish to leave you with that thought of encouragement tonight as well.
Yes, Darren, I'd like to introduce Dr. Westermeyer at this time. Friends, Dr. Westermeyer is an excellent physician. He's a credible scholar, and recently he's become a good friend of ours. Friends, he is someone that you can trust. And Dr. Westermeyer, we thank you for bringing us this presentation tonight, and we'd like to turn the time over to you now.
Thank you. Good evening, friends. My wife and I and girls have enjoyed being a part of this Christ 2000. Our hosts here in Tanzania have been so gracious to us, and we have really admired the great work, the extraordinary work they have done to put this meeting together. You know, on this issue of AIDS, all the statistics in the world mean nothing to you until it touches someone close to you. And I know that because I have stood by the grave of a young school friend of mine in America and wept. And I have also stood by the bedside of a young, beautiful Tanzanian woman who is dying in a home just down the street from this stadium in Mwanza. And the great tragedy of this disease is that it strikes our youth and young adults who are the strength and the future of our countries. And I think there are very few that are listening tonight who have not known someone close to them that has fallen to this deadly disease of AIDS. Now, just last week, the United Nations met in special session in New York City to discuss the HIV situation, and they released this statement. Listen to these words. We are deeply concerned that the global HIV/AIDS epidemic, through its devastating scale and impact, constitutes a global emergency and is one of the most formidable challenges to human life and dignity. We are convinced of the need to have an urgent and a coordinated and a sustained response to the epidemic. You know, look around you tonight, friends, in this stadium. Every day, 20,000 people become newly infected with HIV, almost a group as large as this entire audience. In the last 20 years, we have seen this become one of the leading causes of death in the world. And the thing that strikes me is the fact that by the year 2010, more people will have died of this disease than have died in all the wars, all the terrible wars that we have seen in this world in the past 100 years. In some of the areas that are listening tonight, as many as one out of every four young adults is already infected and will not survive long, and it is causing social and economic chaos in parts of the world. And it's no wonder that the leaders in the United Nations are calling this a global emergency and desperately looking for solutions to stop this spread. One of the most frightening things about this disease is the fact that many people, 90%, the World Health Organization tells us, do not even know right now that they're infected. This virus can invade the body and can be spread to other people before the person is actually aware that they are sick, and others will become infected. Now, we must recognize tonight that there are many innocent victims to this disease. There are children born to infected mothers. There are victims of abuse and unfaithful spouses. There are those that are accidentally infected by infected blood or needles. But that should not distract us from the fact that the vast majority of HIV and AIDS in the world has been caused by casual sexual contacts. And we must tonight focus on the real problem and the real solutions. I need to tell you as I begin that I'm the father of two young daughters who are in the audience this evening. And because I love them, I have talked to them in the same way that I'm talking to you, because I don't want them to undergo the terrible suffering and death that can come from HIV and AIDS. Well, how has the world responded to this terrible disease? For years, the world has said that you are safe as long as you use a condom during your sexual activities. But friends, millions and millions of condoms have been distributed around the world, and people are still dying by the thousands every day. So tonight we must ask the question, does the condom protect us from HIV/AIDS? Am I safe when I use a condom? And like all deceptions, it is a partial truth. We took a boat ride last week out in the beautiful Lake Victoria nearby here. And out on a rock, we saw three large crocodiles sunning themselves. And I asked my young daughter, I said, would you like to go swimming out with these crocodiles? And she said, no, because she understands, like you, that crocodiles can be dangerous. Let me ask you a question. If there were two lakes, and one of them had 10 crocodiles in them, and one of them had one crocodile, which one would you choose to go swimming in? Some of you might say, well, I'd swim in the one with only one crocodile. But friends, I wouldn't go swimming in either of those lakes. It's true, it's safer to swim in the lake with one crocodile, but it only takes one crocodile to bring death and destruction. And that's how it is with condoms when you use them for sexual relations with a person with HIV and AIDS. It's like choosing to swim in the lake with the one crocodile instead of the 10. It is a little safer, but some condoms are defective. Some break, and many who have trusted the condoms to protect them have been infected by this deadly disease. You know, at a large AIDS conference a few years ago, my father-in-law stood up and asked the doctors and the researchers that were at that conference if they would be willing to trust a condom to protect them if they knew their sexual partner was infected with HIV. Not one person in that room would raise their hand because they were not willing to risk their life to something as fragile as a condom. So we need to ask ourselves, is there a better solution? Is there a safer way to protect ourselves from the danger and the suffering and the death that comes from HIV and AIDS? Last week, when the United Nations met to discuss this global emergency, their summary statement said this: we want to emphasize the important role of cultural, family, ethical, and religious factors in the prevention of this epidemic, encouraging responsible sexual behavior, including abstinence and fidelity. Friends, that was the United Nations speaking just 5 days ago. I was stunned to hear this because, you know, for the first time in the 20 years of the global HIV epidemic, the world has said we need to look to family and spiritual leaders to help find the solution to this crisis. So friends, this evening, as Christians, we can no longer remain silent. The world is asking us for our help in this crisis, and it is our responsibility before God to proclaim what the Bible has taught us about what truly safe sexual conduct is. And I'm going to speak, and we must speak plainly tonight. Jesus said that God's plan for sexual relationships was one man and one woman for life. At the beginning of the creation, Jesus said, God made them male and female, and for this reason, a man will leave his father and mother and be united to his wife, and the two will become one flesh. What God has joined together, let no man separate. Friends, there's no question that Jesus was talking here about sexual relations and commitment in marriage. His plan was for no sexual relationships before marriage and then faithful commitment to one partner for life. God's plan is the only truly safe way. There are no crocodiles in the water of abstinence before marriage and faithfulness to your marriage partner throughout life. You know, in the Sermon on the Mount, Jesus said, blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall what? See God. And later, Jesus' disciple John said, everyone who has this hope purifies himself, even as he, that is Jesus, is pure. Jesus said there would be two paths, a broad path that would lead to destruction, and many would follow that path. And friends, this evening, there are many who are following the path of casual sexual conduct to destruction. But then Jesus added that there would be a narrow path that only a few would follow to eternal life. Friends, what path do you want to be on tonight? In 1 Corinthians, Paul says, don't be deceived. The sexually immoral will not inherit the kingdom of God. Now you may say, What you're asking is impossible. Young people will never change their sexual behavior. I've heard this said in America, and I've heard it said here in Tanzania. But friends, as followers of Jesus Christ, we must remember what Jesus said to his disciples. Do you remember when they went to him one day and they said, Master, what you're saying is impossible? And Jesus turned to them and he said, well, it's true. With men, it is impossible. But with God, all things are what? Possible. Do you believe that, friends? If we have failed, even if we failed, there is always a new beginning in Jesus Christ. Even if, like David, we have been involved in sexual impurity, we can pray and turn away from our sins as David did and say, create in me a pure heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me. And with God's strength, we can live a life of purity and follow God's plan for saving sexual relationships for marriage and committing ourselves to that one partner for life. You know, friends, Dr. and Mrs. Patzer taught their family as they were growing up these principles of the family. And for me, it was wonderful to see a young, beautiful couple like Darren and Natalie, their son and daughter-in-law, testify about how that decision brought happiness and stability to their marriage. And I want you to know, friends, that thousands and thousands of young people around the world have made a decision to follow God's plan and to save the sexual relationships for marriage and stay committed to that one person for life. And you too can make that decision tonight. And as I close here, I want to speak to another group of people, because I know that in an audience the size that we have, there are many that have perhaps not followed God's plan for sexual purity and committed to marriage as God designed it. And there are those that may be listening that are already infected with HIV and are already suffering from its effects. And to you, I want to say, we have a friend in Jesus who loves you. We have a God who opens his arms wide in compassion and forgiveness. And you can have peace and assurance in Jesus. And you can know that, as Pastor and Dr. Patzer said last night, that one day he will remove the curse of sin. And he will wipe every tear with our eyes. And he will be with us in our time of need. And those of us who are already as followers of Christ, we must accept these people into our midst with love and compassion of Jesus. We must reach out and care for the innocent children who have been left orphaned and often homeless. And we must be willing to be God's hands to help them in their time of need. Tonight, friends, Pastor Jeffrey Mabwana, president of the Tanzanian Union of Seventh-day Adventists, is here with my own daughter, Allison, and Margaret from Mwanza, her new friend. And he's going to lead them in time of commitment and prayer. And we've asked my daughter, Allison, and Margaret if they would carefully consider what would be their response to this challenge and to the temptations that will be ahead of them in the years to come.
I would like to live a life of purity and commit myself to follow God's plan for faithfulness in marriage someday. God has promised by His grace to help me keep this commitment.
By God's grace, I would like to live a life of purity and commit myself to follow God's plan for faithful in marriage.
To the young people out there tonight, this is a very special moment for each one of you. As you will have heard it from Dr. Weimeister, AIDS is no myth. It is real. You may not be a victim tonight, but let me tell you this, you can be any moment unless you make a sincere and decided decision to commit your life to the leading of the Lord Jesus Christ, just like Allison and Margaret has done tonight. I'm here for a very special purpose. Would like to make a prayer of commitment for all of those youths listening to us tonight who would like to commit their lives to the leading of the Lord Jesus Christ. And before I do that tonight, let me ask the youth listening to us, Are there any who would like to join Allison and Margaret in making a similar commitment to their Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ? For if they are, just before I make this important prayer, special prayer on your behalf, would you like to stand up where you are, all the youths? This is a special moment for you, and if you hear me, stand up where you are as I make a prayer of commitment on your behalf. Shall we pray? Our Father and God of the youths, this is a very special moment for every youth that is standing before you. For I know you love each and every one of them. You care for them, for you died for them. You paid a price that nobody has paid just for them. And just because you care that much, they have decided on their own volition to stand before you to indicate that they would like to commit their entire life to your leadership and lordship. They are threatened because they live in a world full of sin. When they look and hear what happens around them, they despair. It seems to them that there is nowhere that they can, and nobody that they can turn unto. And tonight we want to thank you because you are there for them, to receive them and to accept them just as they are. And therefore tonight, on their behalf, it is my prayer, Father, that you accept them now as they commit their lives unto your leading. May you enshroud them with your love. Throw your arms around them. Let them feel the warmth of your love. And let them feel that nobody cares as much as you do. May they feel your presence every day in their lives as they walk the paths of this sinful world. Encourage them and let them know that you are their God and their Father. Whenever they remember to call on your name, please hear them and answer their prayer. Tonight, therefore, Lord, as you accept each one, grant them victory over sin. And may they live a life free of sin, filled with joy, because you have ruled over their lives. It is our prayer tonight that you take them as they are come and lead them all the way. For this is our prayer through the name of Jesus, who is the friend of all the youths. Amen.
After that special feature, let us sing to the glory of God.
I found a way in Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. I found a way in Jesus, is my way to heaven. I found a way in Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. I found a way in Jesus, is my way to heaven. No one can stop me now.
Thank you, Pastor. Another beautiful evening here tonight. I know you enjoyed what has happened so far. Well, let's see. Tonight we have many people watching that speak the French language. Let's see if we can say good evening, everybody, to them. Bonsoir, tout le monde. Good evening, my French-speaking brothers and sisters. That was an excellent, powerful special feature. Darren, Natalie, Dr. Westermeyer, the girls, and our president. I can't help but again see the importance of Scripture as it relates to the issue of purity. This whole topic of AIDS, reminded of the Bible where it says in Psalm 119, 9-11, how can a young man or woman keep their way pure? By living according to your word, it says, your word have I hid in my heart that I might not sin against you. Even in this topic, we come right back to our foundation, the Bible. Just want to thank them for touching my heart, and I know it did hundreds of thousands of you tonight as well. Well, we're going to talk about the first 1,000 years of eternity. First 1,000 years of eternity. Now, I don't know about you, but where I come from, often I will go through a checkout line at a grocery store, and there'll be some big newspaper there with a headline telling me something special about the future, how the world's going to blow up, or how it's going to be melted down, or there's going to be atomic blast somewhere, or something. And I guess some of us Americans aren't as smart as we think we are, or else they wouldn't be able to sell so many of those magazines. Tonight, I've got great news for you, friends. The Bible is very clear what's going to happen in the future. And by the time you leave tonight, you are going to have an accurate description of what will happen during the 1,000 years just in the future. Now, let me ask you a question. Do you know anyone who's 100 years old? Do you? I have a friend back in the United States that's 100 years old. He's a retired pastor. He's still active. He even writes wonderful poetry. But did you know that 100 years will pale into insignificance because you and I are going to live 1,000 years in heaven? That's what the Bible says. And that's the topic for the study. The millennium. 1,000 years of eternity. Oh, it's going to go on beyond that, but we're going to talk about the first 1,000 years tonight. Now, thinking people are asking, as they look at the world that we live in, seemingly everyone wants to know, what lies just ahead? We see the moral decay in our society, as the doctor just talked about. Our planet is becoming more polluted. We all know that. False Christs that we talked about the other evening are rising. There are international conflicts and famines and earthquakes. These are all in the news on a regular basis. And AIDS is at pandemic proportions around the world. The people are asking, what lies just ahead? Now, as we begin this brand new millennium we're living in right now, beyond the year 2000, thinking people are continuing to ask, is anyone in control? Do you know that the Bible tells us in Amos 3, verse 7, surely the Lord God does nothing unless he reveals his secrets to his servants, the prophets. That's right. We can go to God's word. We can find out what is going to happen, friends. You see, some people have asked the question, how do you find truth in this confused world? Where do we look? I want to tell you that only in God's word can we find truth. We've always gone to God's word in this series of meetings, and remember, if it's in the Bible, I believe it. If it's not in the Bible, then it's not for me. And so as we look at the world today, we see very interesting things happening. Perhaps you've noticed that all across the world, whether it's in Africa, where you live, many of you tonight, in the South Pacific, where some of you are watching, former Soviet Union, Russia, Europe, the Far East, Asia, South and Central America. We hear again and again and again about the end of the world and rumors to that effect. And thinking people are wondering, will there be anyone left to turn out the lights when we leave? Now in the United States, Europe, and Africa, there's a popular new book, and that's been made into a movie titled Left Behind, that erroneously predicts how the world will end. When we look at the nuclear garbage on the earth, when we think of the potential of nuclear disaster, when we realize that we're certainly living in a very dangerous time in this world's history, and we also realize that we're living in an exciting time. Now, we've already studied about when Jesus would come. Now tonight, we want to look at what will happen when Jesus returns ahead and then after the second coming of Christ. You see, Revelation 1:7 tells us, "Behold, he is coming with clouds, and every eye will see him, even they who pierced him, and all the tribes of the earth will mourn because of him." Even so, it says, amen. Now, Jesus is coming in the clouds just as he went up in the clouds. He's coming the same way, in the same manner, to take his loved ones home. It's recorded there in Acts 1:11. But there's something else that's going to happen. Notice as we look at the Bible in Revelation 21:1-3, "Then I saw an angel coming down from heaven, having the key to the bottomless pit and a great chain in his hand. And he laid hold of the dragon, the serpent of old, who is the devil and Satan, and bound him for 1,000 years. And he cast him in a bottomless pit. He shut him up, set a seal on him so that he could deceive the nations no more till that 1,000 years were finished. But after these things, the Bible says, he must be released for a little while." Now, as we studied before, when Jesus comes the second time, the trumpet will sound and the dead in Christ will rise first. Those who have fallen asleep in Jesus, in other words, those who will be resting in their graves, will go up to meet Jesus in the clouds. We studied that at great length the other evening. And the rest of us who are alive, when Jesus returns, will ascend with the resurrected ones up into heaven to meet Jesus. And the Bible says there in Paul's word in 1 Thessalonians 4:17, "Then we who are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. And thus we shall always be with the Lord." And Revelation 26 tells us that there are two resurrections. Two resurrections. Listen, "Blessed and holy is he who has part in the first resurrection. Over such the second death has no power, but they shall be priests of God and of Christ, and shall reign with him," here we are again, 1,000 years. You see, the first resurrection takes place at the beginning of the millennium, the 1,000-year period that we're talking about tonight. That's when Jesus returns that first time. And then Revelation 20 speaks about the 1,000-year period. The word millennium means 1,000 years. Christians often refer to the period of the 1,000 years after the second coming of Christ, before the heavenly city comes down to this earth, as the millennium. Now, Revelation 21:3 goes on and it says, "Then I saw an angel coming down from heaven, having the key to the bottomless pit and a great chain in his hand, and he laid hold of the dragon, that serpent of old, who is the devil and Satan, and bound him for 1,000 years. And he cast him in the bottomless pit, as we said before, shut him up, set a seal on him, so that he should deceive the nations no more till those 1,000 years were finished. But after these things, he must be released for a little while," the Bible says. So, the first resurrection takes place When Jesus comes back the second time to take his loved ones home with him, the rest of the dead, those who die, those who reject Jesus, do not live for the 1,000-year period. Then they are resurrected. This is the second resurrection that the Bible talks about. John 5, 28 and 29 goes on and says, "Do not marvel at this, for the hour is coming in which all who are in the graves will hear his voice and come forth. Those who have done good to the resurrection of life, and those who have done evil to the resurrection of condemnation." You see, the second resurrection will take place, the resurrection of the condemned. And after the millennium, after the 1,000 years, there is 1,000 years between the first resurrection and that second resurrection. But now let's look at these events in order. Okay, Mao, Owen, Botswana. There are at least five events that start the millennium. There are at least five events during the millennium, and there are at least five events that end the millennium. So let's look at the first five events that begin the millennium. First, number one, the second coming of Christ. Jesus said in his own words, "Let not your heart be troubled." Friends, we live in a troubled world. I don't need to tell you that tonight. Jesus has given that assurance, though, that as we look all around us and realize that we are living right on the brink of eternity, we recognize that this old world cannot last forever. Jesus says himself, John 14, 1-3, "Let not your hearts be troubled. You believe in God? Believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you, and if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you to myself, that where I am, there you may be also." You see, Jesus is saying here, I don't want you to be troubled, friends, my children. He doesn't want us to be afraid. He wants us to have peace and joy in our hearts, knowing that he's coming back the second time. So the first event that begins the new millennium is the second coming of Christ. The second event is the resurrection of the righteous. 1 Thessalonians 4:16 says, "For the Lord himself will descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of an archangel, and with the trump of God, and the dead in Christ will rise first." We talked about this text the other evening. It's a great one. It's one of my favorite. So the second event that begins the new millennium is the resurrection of the righteous. Friends, isn't it wonderful to talk about this topic and to focus on the resurrection of the righteous? There isn't one of us that doesn't have a loved one that has died. And it's going to be thrilling to be at the cemetery by their graveside when Jesus comes back, and then to be able to watch as those tombs pop open. Those who have fallen asleep, believing in Jesus, are going to come up out of the graves. The resurrection is going to take place. And whole families, praise God, are going to be reunited when Jesus comes back. That's the second event, the resurrection of the righteous. It begins the new millennium, the 1,000-year period. Notice what the Bible says about it in 1 Corinthians 15:51-53. "Behold, I tell you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed in the moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trumpet." There's that sound again. The trumpet will sound, and the dead will be raised incorruptible, and we shall be changed. For this corruptible must put on incorruption, and this mortal must put on immortality. You see, all through the Bible, death is referred to as what? Gweru Zimbabwe. All of you watching at the downlink site. It's referred to, we talked about it the other evening over and over again, it's referred to as sleep. When we fall asleep in Jesus, We die in him and wait for that resurrection. Notice the rest of the text. It says, in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trumpet, for the trumpet will sound, and the dead will be raised incorruptible, and we shall be changed. For this corruptible must put on incorruption, and this mortal, it goes on and says, must put on immortality. Friends, we're going to be changed. That's what the Bible says right there. We're going to be changed. We're going to receive new bodies, immortal bodies. Notice again that text in Revelation 26 where it says, blessed and holy is he who is part in the first resurrection. Over such, the second death has no power. But they shall be priests of God and of Christ, and shall reign with him 1,000 years. Now the third event, the translation of the living righteous. The third event that takes place at the beginning of the millennium is the translation of the living righteous. That's right. Those who have fallen asleep in Jesus will be resurrected. Then they're going to be taken up. And then those of us who are alive are going to say, hey, Dad, hey, Mom, Grandma, Grandpa, wait for us. We're coming too. And then we'll be taken up. And those of us who are alive, the translation of the righteous. Let's read what it says there as we continue. 1 Thessalonians 4:17. Then we who are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. And thus we shall always be with the Lord. Oh, what a glorious, wonderful, unimaginable event that's going to be. Now, number four, the wicked living are slain. You see, the fourth event is not a pleasant one. It'll bring sadness, great sadness to the heart of God, because God says he is not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. He doesn't want anyone to be lost. In fact, that's why he tarries. The second coming is delayed, so more people can make a decision for Jesus. So the fourth event is that the wicked living will be slain. That's right. It will happen. We read it there in Revelation 6:16. And it says, to the mountains and the rocks, fall on us, hide us from the face of him who sits on the throne and from the wrath of the Lamb. So those who don't love Jesus, those who have chosen their own way time and time again, will be destroyed by that second coming of Jesus. And now we go to number five. Satan is bound to this earth. Satan himself will be bound to this old earth, bound by the chain of circumstances. The Bible says there in Revelation 22 and 3, see, it keeps progressing through there. He laid hold of the dragon, that serpent of old, we talked about him last night, who is the devil and Satan, bound him for 1,000 years, and he cast him into the bottomless pit, shut him up, set a seal on him so that he should deceive the nations no more till the 1,000 years were finished. But after these things, he must be released for a little while. During that 1,000 years, Satan, along with all his evil angels, is bound here to this earth. There's no one to tempt. All the wicked have gone to sleep, waiting for the second resurrection. They have died for the brightness of Christ's coming. And all the righteous are in heaven. No one but Satan, his evil angels, are here on earth. And they are figuratively bound for 1,000 years. So let's review. Five things happening at the beginning of the millennium. One, the second coming of Christ. Number two, the resurrection of the righteous. Number three, translation of the living righteous. Number four, the wicked living are slain. And number five, Satan is bound to this earth. Let's move on. We've got that clear now. Let's look at the five things that we'll be doing during this 1,000-year millennium. Number one, we will be building and rebuilding relationships. Now, friends, some people think that there will be no tears in heaven. I'm here to tell you that there will be tears in heaven. Is that a new thought to you tonight? There will be tears in heaven. Because relationships that were severed on this earth will have to be mended. For instance, in the Old Testament, there's that familiar story of King David who fell in love with the wife of one of his most trusted generals, Uriah. And King David saw Bathsheba and decided that he wanted her for his wife. And if you remember that terrible story, he worked it out so that this trusted general of his, one of his close friends, would end up out on the front of the battle line. And the soldiers would retreat. And Uriah, who was being faithful to his commander, David, was killed on the battlefield. All as David had planned so that he could have Uriah's wife, Bathsheba. Now, friends, Uriah was a godly man. I believe he'll be in heaven. And David repented from the dastardly deed that he did. And I believe David will be in heaven. But friends, can you imagine what it's going to be like when David has to go to Uriah and fall on his knees and say, Uriah, my friend, I have to tell you what I did to you and ask for forgiveness. Don't tell me there won't be tears in heaven. You don't have to go to the Old Testament to know that that will happen. You know, not too many years ago, there was a terrible war right here on this continent in Rwanda, where brothers and sisters killed brothers and sisters. Neighbors killed neighbors. And some of these were Christians. And some of these became Christians. There is a group of these men that are serving in prison right now. They are serving in prison because of the fact that they murdered people. They are condemned murderers who were involved in Rwanda's massacre. Each time they get together, they sing this song in prison. These are the men who sing with tears in their eyes because now they have been converted and they realize the terrible deeds that they committed. And they sing this song with tears in their eyes. This is a loose translation of what it says. It says this: Dear Father, if you can forgive us for the terrible things we have done, and if you can take us to heaven, we will seek out the people that we murdered. We will fall on our knees and ask their forgiveness. Ah, friends, there'll be tears in heaven as relationships are mended. And there'll be tears in heaven when we look around and we see that someone that we planned on spending eternity with is not there. Friends, loved ones, family members, don't miss heaven and cause more tears of your loved ones. Secondly, the Bible tells us that there will be judging of the wicked. David declared that when the Antichrist came, Daniel 7:22, quote, judgment was given to the saints of the Most High. And John says in Revelation 24, basically the same thing, I saw thrones, and they sat on them, and judgment was seen victorious. What it's saying here is that we are going to have to judge the world. Why? Because of what I touched on just a moment ago. If I were to get to heaven, friends, and one of my loved ones were not there, I would want an explanation from God as to why they weren't. And God would put his arm around me, and he'd take me over, and he'd say, Jerry, I have to tell you why he's not there, why she's not there. And then he'd open up those books that I talked about the other evening, and he'd run his finger down that book. And he'd come to the name of one of my loved ones. And he'd say, see, they never gave their life over completely to me. Well, they may have had the right actions outside. They may have looked like they were Christian. But inside, they never gave their heart totally to me. And I'm going to look at that. And with tears running down my face, if that's the case, I'm going to have to judge those people and say, yes, God, I realize you did everything possible that you could do, including sending your own son to die for them. And they chose not to accept you. And I'll have to say, God, you're fair. But there'll be tears in heaven again. And then number three, this is an interesting one. We're going to be judging angels, the Bible says. Know not, 1 Corinthians 6:3, know not that you shall judge angels. Why should we judge angels? Well, very simply, remember that great controversy that we talked about last night. We're going to look at the records and we're going to see why that one-third of the angels, nearly one-half of those angels, chose to follow Satan. And when they're going to be destroyed, we're going to say, God, you did all you could do. And then we're going to look at all those wonderful, beautiful angels, those angels that have guarded us, and our own private angels, and we're going to say, yes, God, thank you. This angel stayed with you. He's a good angel, and he deserves to spend eternity with you. And so we're going to judge angels during that 1,000 years. That should be interesting. And number four, I like this one. You know what we're going to do also? We're going to move into our mansions. How about that? Doesn't matter where you live here, friends. Doesn't matter if you're in the most humble home. God has a mansion for you. In my Father's house are many mansions, he says. Bigger than you can imagine. Bigger than the biggest ones on the hill up behind our hotel. Much bigger. More beautiful. With gold and silver and green grass all around. Moving into a mansion. We're going to do that. And it's going to be big enough that it's going to take a while to do it. And fifth and finally, among the things that we'll be doing during that 1,000-year time, is we're going to have a banquet feast with Jesus and his saints. A banquet feast with Jesus. Can you imagine? Matthew 26:29 says, I will not drink of the fruit of the wine of the vine of that day until I drink it with you in my Father's kingdom. You see, when Jesus had his last supper, he drank down the grape juice. And he said, as he set it back down the cup, I will not drink of it again until I drink it anew with my children in heaven. Oh, what a feast that will be. Can't you imagine tonight? Jesus is thirsty for that grape juice, and he's saying, oh, come home. I got to get them home so I can have another taste of this wonderful juice. And he's going to do a toast to all of us. Oh, what a banquet that will be, as far as we can see, with every imaginable food. And all of our friends and all of our family are going to be lining those tables. Wow, what a banquet that will be. And then there's something else that we're going to do, friends. It comes with this. It's described in a story that's just one of my favorite. It happened to a man by the name of John Jasper. He was the pastor of the 6th Mount Zion Baptist Church in the southern part of the United States. He was preaching one day in this church. He was preaching on the joys that will await God's people in heaven. And the more he preached and the more he thought about the wonders of heaven, The emotion just welled up inside him. And with tears of emotion, he choked up. And he couldn't preach anymore. And finally, he started motioning to his people to leave because he couldn't continue. And he told them to leave. And he just motioned for them to go because tears were streaming down his face as he thought about Jesus and heaven and spending eternity there. But the people were enthralled. They sat spellbound. And John Jasper finally returned to the pulpit. And he started to preach again. And this is what he said. Oh, when I get to heaven, when I get to those pearly gates, my big angel is going to say to me, John Jasper, you want your golden slippers? And I'm going to say to him, yes, angel, John Jasper wants his golden slippers, but not now. And then he's going to say to me, John Jasper, you want that pure, white, beautiful robe? Oh, yes, angel, I want that robe, but not now. Oh, John Jasper will say, the big angel, you want to meet Elijah and Daniel and Moses? Oh, yeah, I want to meet them. I can't wait to see them. Do you want to see your mansion? I have to see my mansion, but not yet. Not yet. You want to see your loved ones? Oh, yes, I've got to see my loved ones. But not yet. Not yet. Oh, big angel, John Jasper said, first, I want to see Jesus. I want to see him first of all. Friends, all those things that we're going to do, from judging the wicked to judging the angels to inhabiting our mansions to having a banquet, the thing that you and I are going to want to do most is to see our Jesus and thank him for what he's done. And so once again, we'll list those five events that take place during the millennium. First, building and rebuilding relationships. Two, judging the wicked. Three, judging angels. Four, moving into those mansions. And five, having that banquet feast with Jesus and spending eternity with our best friend that loves us so much. Doesn't sound like we'll be bored, does it? I can't wait. And now there are five events that will close the end of this millennium. Let's look at those five. Number one, the wicked are going to be raised. That's right. The Bible says it. Revelation 20, verse 5, but the rest of the dead did not live again until the 1,000 years were finished. So after 1,000 years, that second resurrection takes place. The wicked are raised. Number two, Satan is set free. Revelation 27 goes on. Now, when the 1,000 years have expired, Satan will be released from that prison, that figurative prison. The wicked have been raised, so now he has someone to tempt again. So how is Satan released from his prison? He'll have all those wicked people who have been resurrected at the second resurrection be there for him to tempt, for him to organize, because he's going to try to take over the heavenly city. That is how he will no longer be a prisoner. Third, the New Jerusalem, where all of us are going to be, all the saints, the New Jerusalem will come down to this earth. The third of the five events that close the millennium, the New Jerusalem comes down to this earth. What an exciting time that's going to be. I want to be in that city, my friends there in Bagima, Uganda, watching tonight. Don't you? I want to be inside that city, not outside the city, as that New Jerusalem comes down. John goes on there in Revelation 21, verse 2. Then I, John, saw the holy city, New Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. No, friends, what a thrill that will be as that New Jerusalem settles in, comes down. We can't even fully comprehend what that will be like. And Revelation 21:3 goes on and tells us, and it says, "And I heard a loud voice from heaven saying, Behold, the tabernacle of God is with men, and he will dwell with them, and they shall be his people. God himself will be with them, and he will be their God." Have you ever wondered, my friends, what will really make heaven heaven? It's the fact that Jesus is going to be there. He'll be with us. God the Father himself will be there. God the Holy Spirit will be there. We can see and talk and communicate face to face with the God of the universe. That's the thrill of heaven. Having our God, our Creator, our Maker with us in heaven. Now Revelation 29 goes on and tells us what will happen after the New Jerusalem descends to this earth. It says, "And they went up on the breadth of the earth. They surrounded the camp of the saints." These are those wicked angels and those sinners that were not saved. "The saints and the beloved city. And fire came down from God out of heaven and devoured them." Now, as commander-in-chief, Satan himself organizes the wicked after the second resurrection to try to come up and conquer the city. What a battle that'll be. Talk about a battle of the gods. They endeavor to take the holy city. But just as they approach, fire comes down from heaven, and all the wicked are utterly destroyed. Revelation 20:14 describes it, says, "Then death and Hades were cast into the lake of fire. This is the second death." You see, finally, all things are finished. The wicked are totally destroyed. And now we come to the fourth event that takes place at the close of the millennium. These wicked are finally and completely destroyed. They don't burn forever and ever. We talked about that the other evening. No, the Bible doesn't say that. Actually, the word forever, just as a review, the word forever and ever and eternal fire in the Bible means as long as a subject allows. So they're burned up like Sodom and Gomorrah were burned with eternal fire. Those cities were burned up. You can go to the Dead Sea today. I've been there. You can see where the cities used to be. The fire is not still burning, but the cities were totally consumed. You see, those who reject God will be totally consumed. They will be no more. Let us read Jude 7 about Sodom and Gomorrah. It says this, Jude 1:7, "As Sodom and Gomorrah and the cities around them in a similar matter to these, having given themselves over to sexual immorality, gone after strange flesh, are set forth as an example, suffering the vengeance of eternal fire." Now, note what the Bible says. It's very clear concerning the destruction of Sodom and Gomorrah. 2 Peter 2:6, "And turning the cities of Sodom and Gomorrah into ashes, condemn them to destruction, making them an example to those who afterward would live ungodly." So when the eternal fire goes out and the ashes are all that remain, the same way that the wicked will be destroyed in the lake of fire, 2 Peter tells us in 3 verse 10, "But the day of the Lord will come as a thief in the night, in which the heavens will pass away with a great noise, and the elements will melt with fervent heat. Both the earth and the works that are in it will be burned up." It must be, friends, some type of incredible cosmic nuclear meltdown There's no second chance for the wicked at this point. As popular a doctrine as some Christians are now making that teaching, that's not the way the Bible teaches it. There is no second chance after that. The Bible is clear. Revelation 22:11 puts it this way. He that is unjust, let him be unjust still. He which is filthy, let him be filthy still. But he that is righteous, let him be righteous still. And he that is holy, let him be holy still. Now the fifth event that closes the millennium. God then makes a new earth. This is when the earth is made new. This will be one of the most glorious and exciting events in the history of this universe. Let's read out how it's described in Revelation 21:1. Now I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven, the first earth had passed away. Also, there was no more sea. You see, sea represents separation. When John wrote this book, he was sitting on the Isle of Patmos. He was a prisoner. You can still see it today where he was. It's a high cliff. And as he sat there, he said, there'll be no more sea, because as he looked out from that cliff, all he could see was the ocean. And it was that ocean that separated him from his family, from his loved ones. And so to John, heaven was no more sea, because he met no more separation. And there'll be no more separation, friends, from our family then. You know what else the Bible says there'll be no more of? There'll be no more death. There'll be no more mourning. There'll be no more crying. And now, according to Revelation 21:4, now is when there will be no more tears. Praise God. Can you say amen to that? Amen. Jesus said in Matthew 5:5, blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. Yes, all of us have the opportunity to inherit the new earth. So once again, the five events that close the millennium. Number one, the wicked are raised. Satan is set free. The new Jerusalem comes down to earth. The wicked are destroyed. And then this old earth is made new. So, now we know how the future will unfold. The Bible is crystal clear. But the only thing yet to be determined is where you and I will spend that future. And that decision, friends, is up to us. Revelation 22:17 says, and the Spirit and the bride say, come. Let him who hears say, come. And let him who thirsts come. Whoever desires, let him take the water of life freely. Oh, friends, you've got to love a Jesus like that. Jesus reaches out his hand to us in love, and he says, come, come, take the water of life freely. Accept the free gift of salvation. Friends, you can count on that Jesus. He will always be there waiting for you. In 1993, in the country of Turkey, there was a boy named Aman. His father took him to school and told him he'd always be there for him if he ever needed him. As Aman's father went back to his home on the other side of town, there was a terrible earthquake that year. Turkey registered 7.3 on the Richter scale. And Aman's father rushed to where the school was. The epicenter of the earthquake was right near the school. The school was totally demolished. And he remembered about where Amon's classroom was, and he ran to the spot, and feverishly he began to dig with his bare hands. and other parents were in the area, and they were crying. They said to him, "No, leave them alone. They're all dead. They're buried. Just leave them alone. Come." But Amon's father said, "No, you come. Help me. My son Amon is in there. I told him I'd always be there for him." And he continued to dig with his hands for hours. Hours passed. Finally, the fire department came. And they came up to him and they said to him, "Sir, this is a restricted area. You have to leave." And he said, "No, no, I won't leave. My son is in there." And they said, "You are a crazy man. Stop this foolish digging." He said, "No, come and help me. I promised my son a man. I would always be there for him. You must help me. Please help me." Amon's father continued to dig with his hands. By now they were bloody and they were warm, but he continued to dig. And he dug deep and deeper and for more hours. After 24 hours, finally the police came to him and said, "Sir, we're sorry, but we've come to arrest you. You are out of your mind." But Amon said, "No, you must help me. My son Amon is there. I told him I'd always be there for him. Come, help me. Help me find him." And they told him, "Oh, go ahead, crazy man, dig." And 20 hours went by. And then 30 hours went by. And Amon's father continued to dig with his bare hands. 32 hours went by. He had dug a large hole by now, moving those boulders and those bricks and that rubble. And then there was a large stone in front of a hole. And he tugged and he pulled on that stone, and he finally got it away. And inside that cavity, he cried out in the darkness, "Amon! Amon! Amon!" And then he heard it, a tiny little voice. "Daddy, Daddy." Amon and several of his classmates had hunkered down in that little hole. They were still alive. Amon threw his arms around his daddy's neck and he said, "Daddy, Daddy, I knew you'd come for me. I told my friends you'd always be there for me." Friends, I'm here to tell you tonight, your Heavenly Father is always there for you. He's always there for you. Jesus, His Son, holds out His bloodied hands. He wants you to come to Him. And I want you to make that special decision tonight to accept Him right now. Don't you love Him? He's coming back very soon for you. We're living at the very end of time. We studied it the other night. We're living just before Jesus is going to come the second time. He promised. Do you remember the promise? He said, "Let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God? Believe also in me. In my Father's house," he said, "are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go to prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there you may be also." Friends, tonight, I want you to think about that promise. He'll always be there for us. Listen while the men sing.
trumpet sounds within my soul. I ain't got long to stay.
Tonight, what they just said, what they just sang is absolutely true. You don't have long to stay here. One way or another, you don't have long to stay here. Either you're going to go to heaven with Jesus and respond to his call, or you're going to go into your rest and be eternally lost. Heaven forbid that that would be the case. The second choice. But you could tell tonight, the Bible is very clear how it's all going to end. And as I said before, the only thing yet to be determined, friend, is how you and how I will respond. Tonight, I'm going to just ask for a general recommitment or a general commitment for the first time or another one. Just a standing commitment to say, yes, Jesus, I'm on your side. If that's your wish tonight, if you want to say before heaven, Jesus, I know you're always waiting for me. I want to accept you into my life again tonight or for the first time. Then while the men sing that one more time, just bow your head and commune with God and tell him how much you love him and how you want to spend eternity with him. Trumpet sounds within my soul. I ain't got long to stay. Ah, beautiful, men. Thank you. We don't have long to stay here, friends. Whatever the condition tonight in your home, in your neighborhood, in your life. That's the assurance. It's not going to last much longer, and that should bring hope to every one of us. Just before I have that final closing prayer of dedication and commitment, I want to say one more time to those of you watching at the downlink sites, man, father, husband, if you haven't stood yet, I invite you right now to stand to your feet and make a commitment to Jesus Christ because you want to be in heaven. There's no way in the world that you want to bring tears to your family in heaven because you're not there. I invite you right now to stand to your feet. Make it a united family. Mother, wife, young girl, you've got family that love you so much. They will do anything to spend eternity with you that they can do, but it's your choice. If you're not standing right now or that commitment isn't sincere, I invite you to make it sincere right now. Accept Jesus into your life. He loves you so much. You just can't turn it down. And young boy, young girl, you got a whole life ahead of you. Hopefully most of it will be in heaven. But make that decision tonight. Maybe it's even a decision for purity, like we heard at the beginning of the program. Decision to follow Jesus all the way. As you stand tonight, you're saying to Jesus, Jesus, I want to spend eternity in heaven with you, with my family, with my loved ones, with my friends, and with all those wonderful big angels. Oh, that'll be fantastic. Tomorrow night's topic is so many blessings. You don't want to miss that one because it's going to give us the answers to how you can be blessed. Feel like sometimes other people are blessed and you aren't? Tomorrow night, you can find out what the Bible says, how you can be blessed. We'll see you tomorrow night, but let's have our prayer and ask God to bring us back. Father in heaven, tonight we've talked about eternity. We realized that as we studied the other night, we're right on the brink, right on the beginning of this thousand-year millennium. And all kinds of wonderful, fantastic, exciting things are going to happen. And every one of us stood to our feet tonight, Lord, saying, thank you for making it possible that we can be there. Now, Lord, this decision we've made can't be kept on our own. We need your power in our life to be victorious. So, Jesus, first we want to tell you we love you. And we want to tell you thank you for what you've done. And then thirdly, we want to ask you to give us the power to successfully live the way you want us to live in all manner of our actions. Bless us to that end. Be with all these people and bring us back tomorrow night, praising you in Jesus' wonderful name. Amen.
The airtime of this program was sponsored by the generosity of 3ABN viewers and supporters.